the pale moon shining on the fields below. The donkey's crooning song soft below. You need tell me more because I know more. When it's sleepy time drowns out, Baba Zuzazi. Soft and blowing through the pine wood trees, babe. Folks down there living life for me. When old mammy falls down on her knees, oh man. When it's sleepy time down,
This is Jazz Casual, and I'm Ralph Gleason, and that voice and that music is the voice and the music of jazz's number one ambassador to the world, Louis Armstrong, who is with us today to talk about some of his music. Louis, welcome to Jazz Casual.
Thank you very much,
It's an honor to have you here, and I'm sure that, like many other people that have been interested in jazz, have been fans of jazz, I can say that I grew up loving this music, and this means that I grew up loving you, and been fascinated by it, and fascinated by the things you've done, and have wanted to know so many different things about the records that you've made. You've been recording now for, 40 years. The first record you made back with King Oliver in Chicago in 1923. I thought it might be interesting if we could play for our audience some of these records and then talk to you about them a little bit. And if we could start out hearing the King Oliver Creole Jazz Band with Louis Armstrong and King Oliver on cornets playing Snake Rag.
Thank you.
You know, I've always wanted to ask you, it never was my pleasure to hear that band. Do these records do that band justice?
Yeah, I don't know. We did pretty good without the drums in those days, you know.
Oh, he didn't use the drums at
we
all?
They didn't have no drums, and then they didn't have mics, and they just had one big horn, you know.
Did they line you all up, like on a bandstand? Or?
Well, we stood in front of this horn and played. And any man that had a solo had to get in that horn, else he wouldn't be heard, you know? So that's the advantage they have today, you know, with the...
Well, when you played those breaks with Joe Oliver, were the two of you standing right in front of the horn?
In front of the horn, else he wouldn't have caught it, you know?
Had you played with Oliver before you came up to Chicago?
Well, he used to come by the living in Bedita, there where the Storyville, nightly, he used to come back and... I used to play in the Honky Tonk, and he used to come from down in the Storyville and come up there where I played, because he got off at 12 o'clock at night and seeing they threw the key away where I played, you know. So he'd come up there and sit down and listen to me play, and then he'd blow a few for me, you know, and try to show me the right things.
Well, when he went on to Chicago, did you think he would send for you?
No, at that time, I had no idea he would.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. I was playing in the Tuxedo Brass Band and with Kid Ory, too.
Mm-hmm.
And I just had left the excursion boats. Yeah. I went in there in 1919. Then I played with Kid Ory. And then around 1922, I was playing with the Tuxedo Brass Band, Celestine.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's when King Oliver sent for me to play second trumpet with him at the Lincoln Gardens.
And you were surprised?
Well, I was surprised. I was happy. Couldn't nobody else get me out of New Orleans but him. I wouldn't take that chance.
But you hadn't heard the band until you got to Chicago.
I hadn't heard his band until I got to Chicago. Then I, when I heard it at the door, I said, I ain't good enough for this band. I think I'll go back. that's that was a highlight of, my biggest moments.
Well, was this a different kind of a band than bands that you had played with in New Orleans?
Well, it was the same setup, but see, we didn't have no pianos in New Orleans. We had guitars.
Yeah.
Lil was on the piano here. See what I mean?
And was he using two cornets before you came up?
No, just by himself.
Yeah.
And I don't know, the band was wailing.
Yeah.
I fit right in there with sitting with Joe because I admired him so anyway, you know.
Well, did you, when you first came in to hear the band, were they playing tunes that you knew?
Well, the usual Dixieland numbers in New Orleans, because there was others that I didn't know, like these, they would come up later, he wrote these.
Mm-hmm.
But we played the usual Panama and the things that we did in New Orleans, you know, with the blues and things like that.
Now, before you started in with a band like that, with Joe's band, when you got to Chicago, did you have to rehearse with them?
No, I just went to work.
Just went to work with them?
Yeah, that's all.
Wow.
I knew all the boys.
Yeah.
And then the routine, you know. And I just sit in there and went to work the next night.
Well, now when he would
I played second trumpet to everything he played.
Just like that.
Second cornet at the time. Because we both was using cornets, you know.
Well, now when you went in to make a record date, like Snake Rag, and had you been playing this tune? Had he been?
Not this one.
Yeah.
It's one of them he made up for the Jeanette record. When he started making records, then he started being a writer, you know.
Yeah.
A lot of that stuff come up later, you know.
Would you rehearse that then in the studio before you recorded it?
Well, we'd rehearse that on the job, you know. And by the time we get to the studio, all they do is cut it up and time it, you know.
Yeah.
But no trouble at all, you know, to make them records, because they'd make one after another. It wasn't as particular as it was today, you know.
Well, you don't think you made mistakes in there, do you?
Well, it ain't that, but we could have had more lead.
Uh-huh.
See, we could have pushed Joe up or stand him out, or we could have played a little softer.
Put a balance on it.
So they could have heard that lead.
Yeah.
And that's where, in all them old records, you lose that lead.
Uh-huh.
See what I mean? You notice when everybody got the blowing that, and then the lead was gone.
Now, you spoke before about how they didn't have the drums. Baby Dodge just played woodblocks.
I doubted Baby was down.
Yeah.
on those dates.
Uh-huh.
They didn't need him, no way.
They didn't use drums at all in recording?
No drums at all at that time. They were scared it would throw the needle off.
I see, yeah.
So we got by good. But the only thing I have about those early recordings that he didn't get that lead much. And that's what hurt him, because you couldn't tell Joe what to do.
Yeah.
He was the boss.
Yeah. Well, now those breaks that you two took on there.
Well, yeah, I put notes to his lead, whatever he made. We didn't write it.
Did you rehearse it?
No, just for the moment. He'd tell me while the band is playing, what are you going to play? I'm like, what is this? I got my notes.
It gives
and
you
that's
cues.
That's why all the musicians used to come around and hear us do that, you know. They thought that was no secret we had.
You had everybody cool on that.
Yeah, Mix and Louis Panico, Paul Whiteman, and all the boys used to come around, you know. And they thought that was something.
And he would change the things he was going to do from night to night until.
Yeah, whatever he was going to do, he let me know about 4 or 5 balls ahead while the band was jumping, you know.
Was it a different kind of excitement to play with this band coming up from New Orleans for you, for the inspiration?
That was a big thing for me.
Yeah.
Yes, it was. Because I admired Joe so much. Yeah. You know, for him to send for me, I thought that was something.
Now, did you get, in this band, when you were playing second cornet to him, did you get to play solos all by yourself, too?
Very seldom.
Mm-hmm.
One or two records, I think it was Chimes, Blues, or something like that. But I never wanted to do nothing over Joe.
Uh-huh. Did you sing at all?
No.
Not at that time? That came later.
Yeah. Because he knew I was singing, but the main thing was the cornet play with him. Yeah. And I was singing in a little quartet, and he knew all of that, you know?
Was there any vocalist with the band?
No vocalist.
But then you made records shortly after that.
With
vocalists, with Bessie Smith. And.
But that was when I went with Fletcher Henderson,
after
I left Joe, 1924.
I thought we could play one of the records by Ma Rainey that you played on as an example of the kind of blues of that period and the blues singers and the way in which you worked with them. This one is called Counting the Blues. By Ma Rainey, with the accompaniment by Louis Armstrong, Fletcher Henderson, group from the Fletcher Henderson Band. Ma Rainey's Counting the Blues.